Hello students, welcome to 9th lecture of Structure of Atom. We discussed about photoelectric effect in previous lecture, and photoelectric effect is due to the particle nature of electromagnetic radiation. When light or electromagnetic radiation is provided to the metal surface, we are actually throwing photons, that means particles of light, on the metal. These photons will collide with electrons and electrons will be knocked out from the metal surface or metal orbitals, and you will get electron known as photoelectron. So in this lecture we will discuss about dual behavior of electromagnetic radiation. So particle nature of light posed a dilemma for scientists. On one hand, it could explain the black body radiation and photoelectric effect satisfactorily. On the other hand, and it was not consistent with the known wave behavior of light, which could account for the phenomenon of interference and diffraction. We already discussed about interference and diffraction in earlier lectures. The only way to resolve the dilemma was to accept the idea that light possesses both particle and wave-like properties. That means light has particle nature as well as wave nature. That is, light has dual behavior. So to easily understand what is wave. So suppose simple example of wave is when we disturb steady, calm water surface like this. When a drop of water fall on the surface of water, it will create this type of motion, which is known as waves. So this is the example of wave. And we consider light to behave like this. Okay, that means electromagnetic waves should behave like this so that it can explain interference or diffraction. But according to dual behavior, it also behaves like particles. That means electromagnetic radiation will behave as a ball or pen or a stone in your hand or device, anything solid you can imagine. Okay, so it will behave as solid particles as well as waves, as mentioned here in example of water. So we have to accept that light possesses both type of behavior. So depending on the experiment, we find that light behaves either as a wave or stream of particles. That means actually light is either wave, that means disturbance in fabric of space, or we can say that it is a stream of particle. As for example, when bomb blasts, it shoot out particles in all the direction. So we can concentrate on certain particles going in same direction. So light behaves like this. Particles of light, that means photons, are going in a straight direction. Okay, so it represents particle nature of light. So whenever radiation interacts with matter, it displays particle-like properties in the contrast to wave-like properties, interference and diffraction, which it exhibits when the propagates. Now this concept was totally alien to the way the scientists thought about the matter and radiation, and it took them a long time to become convinced of its validity. That means this term is hard to understand. Just imagine we have a solid piece of metal, and we say that it acts as a sound wave as well as it acts as a solid piece of metal, which it should be. Okay, so it is hard to understand how a solid block of metal behaves like sound wave. Similarly, if someone says wave obtained by disturbance of calm water, this wave also behaves like a solid rubber ball. Okay, just like the ball, these waves also give some results, okay, similar to the solid ball. So it is hard to accept that wave has particle nature or particles have wave nature. So light or electromagnetic radiation consists both of them, that means particle as well as wave nature. So it is hard to accept. That's why scientists took long time to convinced about it. So it turns out, as you shall see later, that some microscopic particles like electrons also exhibit the wave particle duality. Okay, we will discuss about it in upcoming points. Now some numericals are mentioned, so let us discuss them quickly. So calculate the energy of 1 mole of photons of radiation whose frequency is 5 into 10 raised to 14 hertz. So we need to find energy of the photon. So in this case only frequency is mentioned, and it is v, and v is equal to in this case 5 into 10 raised to 14 hertz. Okay, and we need to find energy, and equation of energy of photon is h into v, that means Planck constant into frequency of photons. So we will use this equation, and we know that Planck or value of h is constant, so it won't change. So equation will be h into v, where h is equal to Planck constant 6.626 into 10 raised to minus 34, now unit is joules second. On the other hand, our frequency in given example is 5 into 10 raised to 14 second inverse. So let us put this value in our equation. So it will be 6.26 into 10 raised to minus 34 multiplied by 5 into 10 raised to 14. Now units are joule seconds and second inverse. So eventually this will be cancelled out, and final unit will be J, and value will be 3.313 into 10 raised to minus 19. Okay, so this will be the energy of given photon. Now this is the energy of single photon, and we need energy of one mole of photon. So how can we do it? Simple, multiply energy of one photon with one mole, so you will get energy of one mole of photon. So we will multiply energy of one photon with one mole, that means 6.022 into 10 raised to 23, and you will get 19.951 into 10 raised to 4 joules, or in kilojoules this value will be 199.51 multiply by kilojoules, not multiply, so 199.51 kilojoules will be energy of one mole of photon having frequency as mentioned 5 into 10 raised to 14. Next problem is, a 100 watt bulb emits monochromatic light of wavelength of 400 nanometer. Calculate the number of photons emitted per second by the bulb. So here bulb has 100 watts of power, that means it emits 100 joules of energy per second. Okay, so this will be the energy emitted by bulb in 1 second. So now we have to calculate how many photons are present in 100 joules, that means how many photons we need to obtain 100 joules of energy per second. For that we have to find the value of the energy of single photon. And how can we find it? So as mentioned earlier, our equation will be same, energy of photon is equal to Planck constant into frequency, but as we can see in this case frequency is not mentioned, instead we have wavelength, and wavelength is 400 nanometers. Okay, so 400 nanometer wavelength containing light or electromagnetic radiation is present. So what will be the relationship between lambda and v? So we know that c is equal to v into lambda, so it means v is equal to c by lambda. So we can replace the value of v with c upon lambda. So our final equation will be e is equal to hc upon lambda. So now we can put the values. In this case we have two constants and one wavelength, and we know the value of wavelength, so we can put this value in this case, but wavelength is mentioned in nanometers, so we have to convert it into meters first. So now h is equal to 6.626 into 10 raised to minus 34 into c is equal to 3 into 10 raised to 8 meters per second, and lambda, our wavelength will be 400 nanometers, and 1 nanometer is equal to 10 raised to minus 9 meters, so it will be 400 into 10 raised to minus 9 meters. So now let us put all of the units in the calculation and what will happen. So h is equal to joules second multiply by c, unit of c is meter per second, divide by unit of nanometer, unit of lambda will be in meters now. Okay, so meter will be cancelled out, second inverse and second will be cancelled out, so final unit will be joules on only. That means energy will be obtained in joule. So it will be 4.969 into 10 raised to minus 19 joules. So this will be the energy of single photon, or energy of emitted by the photon per second. So this is the energy of one photon, and as mentioned earlier, total energy emitted is equal to 100. So how can you find the number? Simple thing, energy of total divided by energy of one. That means 4.969 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 19. This will give us total number of photons ejected per second, which will be 2.012 into 10 raised to 20 per second. Okay, so what we did, let us repeat calculation quickly. First we used equation E is equal to HV, but as we know V is equal to C upon lambda, so we replaced the value of V with C upon lambda, so we get equation E is equal to HC upon lambda. Now H is a constant, C is a constant, and both of them has fixed value. Lambda is mentioned in nanometer, so we converted into meters. So 1 nanometer is equal to 10 raised to minus 9 meters, so 400 nanometer will become 400 into 10 raised to minus 9. So answer to this is 4.969 into 10 raised to minus 19 joules. This is the energy of one photon only. Okay, so this is the energy of one photon. Now total energy emitted by the bulb is 100 watt. So 100 watt is equal to 100 joules per second. So 100 joules of energy is emitted by bulb, and energy of one photon is mentioned here, 4.969 into 10 raised to minus 19, or we can say that approximately 5 into 10 raised to minus 19 joules. So total energy divided by energy of 1, it will give us numbers. So total energy emitted is equal to 100 joules, emitted by one photon is equal to 4.969 into 10 raised to minus 19. So it will give us total number of photons per second. So 2.012 into 10 raised to 20 photons are emitted by the bulb per second. Okay, so this problem requires a little bit of explanation. So when electromagnetic radiation of wavelength 300 nanometer falls on the surface of sodium, electrons are emitted with the kinetic energy of 1.68 into 10 raised to 5 joules per mole. Okay, so that means provided energy is more than requirement. Okay, so as mentioned earlier, frequency requirement to knock out or eject electron threshold frequency is V0. If you provide exactly energy equals to V0, then ejected electron will have zero kinetic energy. But in this case, we can see electrons have some kinetic energy, which is 1.68 into 10 raised to 5 joules per mole. That means total 1 mole of electrons, if they are ejected, then ejected electron will have total 1.68 into 10 raised to 5 joules of energy. So that means we are providing more than required energy or frequency. So now question is, what is the minimum energy needed to remove an electron from sodium? Okay, so that means we provided more than requirement. This is the more than required amount. So actual requirement is provided energy minus 1.68 into 10 raised to 5. Okay, so this is extra energy absorbed by electron. So first we need to find what is the actual requirement. That means if we provide that wavelength, or that radiation, then removed electron will have zero kinetic energy. Okay, so no wastage of energy first. And what is the maximum wavelength that will cause a photoelectron to be emitted? Now maximum, that means lower in energy. If wavelengths are increased, then energies will be decreased, and if wavelengths are decreased, then energy will increase, because our equation of energy with lambda is E is equal to hc upon lambda, as we discussed in previous numerical. So we know that h and c both are constant, so if we remove the constant, then we have to put proportionality sign. So our equation will be E is proportional with 1 upon lambda. That means energy and lambda are inversely proportional. If lambda increases, it represents energy decreases, or if lambda decreases, it represents energy will increase. So let us understand first what is going on in this numerical. So first of all, we have a sodium. This is the nucleus of sodium, and this is outermost orbital which has one electron. So we provided some electromagnetic radiation to this sodium atom. Now provided radiation has a 300 nanometer wavelength. Okay, so that means wavelength is equal to 300 nanometer. So energy of this wave is total provided energy. So that means our equation will be E is equal to hc upon lambda. When we put the value of hc and lambda in this case, you will get energy of one photon which has 300 nanometers of wavelength. Now we have to multiply this value with Avogadro number, so you will get energy of one mole of photon. Okay, so we will put Na here. So one mole of photon is equal to Avogadro number plus Planck constant plus velocity of light divided by wavelength. So this will give us energy of total one mole photon. That means total provided energy. Now when this 300 nanometer equals energy is provided to this atom, electron will absorb energy from it. Now some of the energy will be used to remove electron from the metal, and if extra energy is provided, then electron will have some kinetic energy equals to extra energy. That means our requirement is, let us call it E0. This is our requirement to eject or to remove electron from the metal surface. But total provided energy is equal to, let us say, E. So difference between these two is the kinetic energy of electron, and here kinetic energy of ejected electron is 1.68 into 10 raised to 5 joules per mole. Okay, that means one mole of electrons contains 1.68 into 10 raised to 5 joules of kinetic energy. So this is the extra amount of energy provided. So first thing, we have to find total provided energy, then kinetic energy is also mentioned. So when we subtract kinetic energy from the total energy, you will get exact energy requirement to eject electron or to remove electron from the metal as photoelectron. So that's why we need total provided energy, and to obtain total provided energy, we will use this equation E is equal to hc upon lambda, and then we will multiply the value with Avogadro number. So our equation will be hc Na upon lambda. This will give us energy of one mole of photons of 300 nanometers. Okay, so this will be our equation, energy of one mole of photon in 300 nanometers wavelength is equal to NaE. That means one mole of energy of photons is equal to one mole multiplied by Planck constant multiplied by speed of light divided by lambda wavelength. So Na 6.022 into 10 raised to 23 multiplied by Planck constant multiplied by velocity of light divided by light. So as mentioned in equation, numerical, we have 300 nanometers is equal to 300 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 9. So this will be equals to, that means energy of one mole of photon will be 3.99 into 10 raised to 5 joules per mole. That means one mole of photon contains 3.99 into 10 raised to 5 joules of energy. Now total energy is equal to 3.99 into 10 raised to 5 joules per mole. This is provided energy. Now energy of the ejected electrons, as mentioned in conditions, it is equal to, that means kinetic energy of ejected electrons is equal to 1.68 into 10 raised to 5 joules per mole. Okay, so we have energy total and energy of electron, that means extra provided energy. Now our target is to find exact value of energy requirement to eject the electron. How can we get it? So as mentioned earlier, this is the total energy, and when we subtract kinetic energy from it, you will get exact amount of energy to knock out the electron. Or in other word, total energy is equal to energy requirement to eject the electron plus kinetic energy of electron. Okay, so we have the value of total energy and we have the value of kinetic energy, so we can find exact amount of energy requirement by subtracting them. So simple subtraction value will be 2.31 into 10 raised to 5 joules per mole. So this is the value of the energy requirement to eject the electrons from the metal surface. Okay, or we can say that in other word, threshold energy. Threshold represents exact amount of energy to knock out the electron. Now from this point we have to reverse calculate this energy. So first of all, what we did, let us repeat what we did, and then we will do the reverse thing. So first thing, we had lambda and kinetic energy of electron ejected. So we calculated energy of the given wavelength, then we subtracted kinetic energy from it. Okay, first from the lambda you will get one photon equals energy, then we multiplied with Avogadro number, so we will get, so you will get one mole equals energy. Then we subtracted kinetic energy from it, and that's why you got threshold energy or energy requirement for the ejection of electron. So how we did, we used first equation, energy is equal to hc upon lambda, and we actually directly used energy of one mole of photon. So this will be our equation. So nae is equal to hc into Na divided by lambda. So you will get energy of one mole of electron, that means this value. Then we subtracted kinetic energy, and now you got threshold energy. So we have energy and we need to find lambda from it. So we will use this same equation. So first of all, this is the energy of one moles of photons. So in first step, we will divide it with one mole, that means Na. So you will get energy of one photon. Okay, so now energy of one photon, that means E is equal to hc upon lambda, and our target is to find lambda. So lambda is equal to hc upon E. This value will give us requirement of wavelength to eject electrons. So let us calculate it. So as we know, E is equal to 2.31 into 10 raised to 5. This is the 1 moles equals energy. That means energy of 1 mole of photon. So we have to divide it with Avogadro number, 6.022 into 10 raised to 23. So equal to 3.84 into 10 raised to minus 19 joules. okay? So this is energy of one photon, and we need lambda or wavelength of this photon, okay? So this is the value of E, and as mentioned, our equation for lambda will be hc upon E. So when we put the value of E in this equation, you will get lambda is equal to 517 nanometers, which falls in green light, okay? So this belongs to green light. We have to provide green light so we can eject the electron, and ejected electrons won't have any kinetic energy. Now the last one, the threshold frequency V0 for the metal is 7 × 10⁴ per second. Calculate the kinetic energy of an electron emitted when the radiation of frequency V 1 × 10⁵ per second hits the metal. So we will use this equation provided by Einstein. So kinetic energy of electron is equal to 1/2 multiplied by me, mass of electron, v square, is equal to h into bracket v minus v0, that means provided an frequency minus threshold frequency. So as we know, h is equal to 6.626 × 10⁴ joules per second. Now provided value is equal to 1 × 10⁵ centimeter inverse minus threshold is 7.0 × 10⁴ centimeter inverse, which is equal to 6.626 × 10⁴ × 10 multiplied by 10⁴. That means 1 × 10⁵ is equal to 10 × 10⁴ minus 7.0 × 10⁴. So this term will be 3 × 10⁴. Now we have to multiply with this, and it will be 1.988 × 10⁻¹⁹ joules. Okay, so this will be our kinetic energy of electron. So we completed all the numericals. If you have any confusion, feel free to ask. We will discuss it again.